thoughtful mind and melt your cold, cold heart.
Tony Bennett's Cold, Cold Heart was on everybody's hit parade. Elizabeth Taylor was getting married. Boys wore ducktails. The police action in the Far East was Korea. And Anarene, Texas, like other small towns, is approaching the end of an era.
I heard about the ball game last night. 121-14. Must be pretty near a record.
What do you think he'd do if he found us?
Shoot us, probably. But, Mama, it's a sin, isn't it? Unless you're married, you know I wouldn't do that. Don't be so mealy-mouthed.
Come it out! Come it out! You've got to be men like the rest of them.
Ain't none of you pretty enough to be women.
You boys can get on out of here. I don't want to have no more to do with you. I've been around that trashy behavior all my life. I'm getting tired of putting up with it.
Oh, quit prison. I don't think you did it right anyway.
Just remember when a dream.
Sonny?
What?
You belong to me.
That's a lie.
I'll stay with her all night one of these nights, too. She done promised.
You won't either.
Yes, I will. Why shouldn't I?
I'm not sorry for you. You left Billy too, just like you left me. I bet you left him plenty of nights. Whenever JC whistled.
So long, buddy.
So long, Dwayne. Be careful. I'll take care of the mercury for you.
I'll see you in a year or two if I don't get shot.
You wouldn't believe how this country's changed. I reckon the reason why I always drag you out here is probably I'm just as sentimental as the next fella when it comes to old times. Old times.
Anarene, Texas, 1951. Nothing much has changed.
Your cold, cold heart.
Welcome to Movie Umpers. I am Bob Sham.
I am Angela.
The sounds you hear may be dogs, and we are at the ass end of November. The last day of November, literally. Leading into December, the Christmas season, though many would say it's the Christmas season right now.
We don't believe in that.
I always want to hang on to Thanksgiving because I love it just a little bit longer. But I can't. But when it's December, go whole hog.
Absolutely.
But you cheated this year. And I know you got your explanation.
I do have my explanation, but go ahead.
She put up a tree in the house in October. Like, what the fuck is that?
Is it decorated like Christmas?
It could be decorated like your Christmas.
It is decorated like Halloween. There is a skeleton on
the top. You would put shit like that on a Christmas tree. We have horror icons in snow... with their faces in like snowflakes.
They're very cool.
They're not leaving that tree, even if you put different decorations.
Those got hung up early because I ordered them for Christmas, but it's a Halloween tree and it's the Bride of Frankenstein and Pinhead and Audrey too, and they're just too cool hang up immediately.
That's what people who are into Halloween would put on a Christmas tree.
Yeah, they're going to be on the Christmas tree. But
you slip that. Look, it's fine.
The orange ribbon will come down.
You can do whatever you want in your home.
I know I can. I'm just saying,
you slip that.
The other thing, though, is that our dog is recuperating from a knee surgery, and he's never had a Christmas tree before. And I thought, let's put up a tree early so you can get used to it. And I've always wanted a Halloween tree. So I felt like I had a good argument. Look at you shaking your head. You don't know what I've wanted.
A Halloween tree?
Yes, people do it. It's a thing. It's also a black tree. And I did buy it to be our Christmas tree because I wanted a black Christmas tree.
And fuck that dog, too.
You love him.
I do. The last day of November, you know, I had an original plan. Our theme all month long was comfort food.
Absolutely.
Which
and you know what's comforting? A tree.
A holiday tree.
A Halloween tree.
I had this plan. We were going to talk about movies from our youth every Monday.
Yes.
Which we get a little nostalgic and beyond. And
comfort food. Beyond nostalgic.
And comfort food also consisted of inspirational movies in which actors are playing people with intellectual disabilities. Mm-hmm. And we've had some real, if you're, for a while, it seemed like we were only talking about good movies. And then it was like, man, we only talk about good movies. Well, this month cured that. All right.
There's still a few good ones in there.
Yeah.
But on the whole,
this month cured it. I don't think they're,
we fleshed out the D's.
Yeah. This time. It was definitely rough to start with those kind of movies.
Yes.
But my original concept was to do Peter Bogdanovich movies starring Cybill Shepherd, the most infamous one being The Last Picture Show, her debut to the world, essentially, on film.
And what a debut.
And the other movies are At Long Last Love, Daisy Miller, and Texasville, which is something of a sequel to Last Picture Show that came out in 1990. Not nearly as popular, not nearly as well-regarded. It seems like maybe Larry McMurty and Bogdanovich, for that matter, were just like, damn, Last Picture Show made us a lot of money. Let's write something else for it. I don't know. But I realized that beyond Last Picture Show, those other movies are so deep cut. They're out of print.
Yeah.
Daisy Miller looks pretty interesting. But yeah, like if you bought them on usually if I don't find them streaming or I don't own them, I'll buy them on DVD. You can get pretty good prices on DVDs unless they're out of print. And those movies I named that are out of print are like $40-$50 to get the DVD.
That's a lot.
I did find them because they're out of print. I did find them streaming on like Daily Motion, those kind of platforms. Quality very up and down.
Yeah.
So I just opted to just change the theme, but I wanted to talk about The Last Picture Show. So I reserved it here in this last week, right before we go into December. The movie of a small town. And we hadn't seen it before until now. We'd heard about it pretty much most of our lives.
It's been always in my mind as something I would eventually see. I had no idea what it was about. I thought it was about the closing of a theater, which and that's in there.
It is, but it's not, but like it's a centerpiece.
The thing.
It's just about a very, it's not over a sack. It's not like saccharine, nor is it like bitter at all. Yeah. It's just pretty straightforward and a pretty earnest representation of a small town that's not meant to be insulting or uplifting.
Right.
And in that way, it's like fucking perfect, honestly.
Yeah.
The Last Picture Show from 1971, directed by Peter Bogdanovich, written by Larry McMurty and Peter Bogdanovich, starring Timothy Bottoms, Cybill Shepherd, Jeff Bridges, Ellen Burstyn, Ben Johnson, Cloris Leachman as Ruth Popper, and Eileen Brennan, amongst others. Successful movie, and it was shot in black and white. Peter Bogdanovich, I watched a little making of documentary. Bogdanovich is all over it, and he was talking about how he was talking with Orson Welles about wanting to do black and white, and Orson encouraged him to just ask the studio. He didn't think they would, but the studio went for it, and it's so fun. There's a picture online of John Huston, Orson Welles, and Peter Bogdanovich sitting at this table.
Yeah.
And Orson said something funny or something, and Peter Bogdanovich has tucked his head into Orson's shoulder, just cackling with laughter.
It's such a joyous photo.
And, like, you could just tell, like, boy, Peter fucking loves him some Orson Welles. He's just like, it's like a cat, like, marking himself on you or something. But it's kind of a sweet photo.
If he had not had that conversation and had not asked to do this, this movie would not be what it is.
The nature, I mean, we're not so far removed. I mean, color had existed in movies for decades up to this point. For sure. But still, a lot of movies were shot in black and white for a long time. Black and white film was cheaper than colorizing, the technicoloring.
Absolutely.
And now it's like the opposite now.
But this was made in 71.
71. But it looks like a classic black and white movie. It's set in the 50s. And there's like casual nudity in the movie. And because it is so convincingly from the 50s, feels like, has that feel. When you see the casual nudity, it kind of like throws you.
It really does.
Because you're
in the most wonderful kind of way.
Because the tone, it feels like you're going into some Hays Code era movie from the 40s or 50s. And then you see in titties and bush, and it's like, oh, whoa. Yeah. It's almost like Bogdanovich made a movie from the 50s if there was no Hays Code and things were more like Europe or something at the time.
And that's what's so wonderful about it. It was actually on black and white film, and everything looks 50s.
Yeah.
Sometimes you'll run into these movies where it's like made in the 70s and it's supposed to be the 50s, and there'll still be like some hairstyles that are like, what are y'all doing?
Yeah.
You know, but this was like so perfectly 50s that, yes, you totally forget. And then it feels like, oh, I'm seeing something I'm not supposed to see.
And
you know, like a slice of life that people don't talk about.
And, you know, the 50s is only like, what, 11, 12 years ago from the point this movie was made?
Absolutely.
And it is, there is some kind of trueness to the idea that a lot of the smaller southern and midwestern towns feel a little bit older and a little bit like a decade behind like the bigger cities.
Yeah.
That's kind of true.
Absolutely.
And so it's pretty easy to evoke that at this time. And I thought they did a great job. But this movie is also very unflinching at the same time. And if you have been around small town environments, honestly, this feels very familiar.
Mm-hmm.
They shot this movie in Archer City, Texas. They call it, I forget the name. I still can't remember the name of the town.
Like, excuse me. It's like...
Okay, it's like...
I almost had it, and then you started talking. It's like
Arena. I think that's kind of right.
You could probably find out faster than what we just did.
There'll definitely be an image with the name of the town on as we're sitting here. Just
you should do one of those little pronunciations.
Anarene, Texas.
Arena. I think that's it.
Anarene, Texas.
I think it is. We're probably wrong. But they shot this in Archer City, Texas, Larry McMurty's hometown. And apparently a lot of people in the town, to some of the things in the movie, were not so hyped on the movie. It felt like it showed a little too much, as you can imagine how small town people would react. But also these actors who, by the way, Bogdanovich separated the actors from the crew.
That's so cool.
Usually... I mean, it caused Bogdanovich to be a fucking dick to the crew, but...
Well, that's not cool, but the end effect is cool.
But what it did was, because usually the crew has to communicate with doing lines or whatever, it's a normal process, but Bogdanovich was the mediator between the crew and the actors, and the actors are all together, and it lit this effect to where they all had this bit of a familiarity with each other, because they were constantly around each other, staying at the motel together... Probably all hooking up, doing drugs when they're not shooting. It was probably like Fleetwood Mac up in that shit, as I understand it probably was. And also, they're shooting in Larry McMurty's hometown, and they're encountering people from Larry McMurty's past that are certainly based on characters that they're playing and that they're characters that they're interacting with based on these people. So you kind of get why this town might take a little bit of things personally.
Absolutely.
But people are cheating, fucking, hitting it with livestock in small towns, apparently. That heifer scene that we'll talk about in a little bit. Definitely Larry McMurty heard a kid say that shit in his life. But yes, the last picture show. Apparently Timothy Bottoms was madly in love with Cybill Shepherd in this movie. Timothy Bottoms, kind of our lead. He's kind of the centerpiece to the web of lives that we're encountering in here. And but when you look up this movie, like in a Google search, it's fucking the character of Jacys, played by Cybill Shepherd, pops up all over the place.
Well, of course.
I mean, we've all known a Jacy, right? A girl who's so dumb pretty, not literally dumb, maybe a little naive, but no more than everyone else. But I mean, so pretty it's stupid, and everyone wants her. But then in the long run, you'd realize. The least luckiest person was the guy that actually got her.
And Genevieve, played by Eileen Brennan, the mother of Twin Peaks.
Yeah, yeah.
I love her so much.
She warns Timothy,
she basically. She says exactly that to him. She's like, Duane thinks he's lucky that he has her, but he's actually not.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, JC, she's playing her own little game, you know, like... I know you were a little angry at JC in this, and you know, she's definitely a little craftier than the men in her life, no doubt.
Well, the thing about JC is that you see her make a change from being like a sweet, sincere girl to using people. She has this trajectory, and her mother, brilliantly and gorgeously played by Ellen Burstyn.
Burstyn in these jeans.
Good God, Ellen Burstyn in this movie.
Ellen Burstyn shows up.
Okay. She, you know, there's this scene where Duane is played by
Jeff Bridges. I love how dumb Duane is.
He's so dumb, but he's like the dumb, cute guy, and she's madly in love with him. They're so in love. They have not had sex yet. And Ellen Burstyn basically says to her daughter, I wish you would. I wish you would have sex with him so you would realize that he's not that great.
Yeah.
That he's just a person. Like, there's this buildup. And this is not untrue. Like, there is this buildup that, like, if you haven't done that and you think of that as, like, the pinnacle of your relationship, you can get caught up in that, like, we're going to be together forever. I'm only going to ever love this person.
These small town boys that go in and out of JC's life, like, her mom's not mad at these boys. She actually kind of likes them, but she literally wants her daughter to just marry a rich guy from Wichita Falls.
Well, and her thing is like, fuck Duane. Fuck him. Yeah. Like, literally.
I love Duane, too, even if you don't like it. I don't care. I just hate to see him marry him, that's all. He wouldn't be rich anymore, and in about 2 months, he'd stop flattering you. Well, you're pretty stupid, then.
Well, you married Daddy when he was poor, and he got rich, didn't he?
Scared your daddy into getting rich, beautiful.
Well, if Daddy could do it, Duane could, too.
Not married to you. You're not scary enough.
Yeah.
But then marry someone who's rich. Like, fuck the pretty boy who's poor. But then you marry someone else. And that's exactly what Ellen Burstyn did. She had love when she was young, which we'll talk about more. But then she married this oil man. And they have a shit relationship. She cheats on him. But the thing about JC is that she ends up going with Randy Quaid to a party in Wichita Falls. And she lies to Duane. And as soon as she lied to Duane and said her mom was making her go to this party where there was going to be a swimming pool, and she'd already been told people were going to be naked. She didn't tell him that part.
Yeah.
She, like, teased him by letting him put his hand between her legs and then was like, I gotta go. It's like she's stringing him along. And then she goes off to this party with Randy Quaid, and it's a naked pool party. And she decides that night that she wants the guy that lives in this house, like the son of these super rich people. And she does she gets totally naked. They're all totally naked.
It's like she walks into another universe where the hedonism is behind closed doors in the small town, and everyone pretends like they're better than they are. But she goes into an area where people have more money, have more wealth. And it's like, hey, come get naked at the pool. It's just like, they have the ability to be a little more open about it. No one can do anything about it.
Yeah, and if she does this thing, like if she stands on the end of this diving board and strips in front of everyone, then she's immediately in this group. Like, she's accepted. But what ends up happening is she's still stringing along Duane, but she wants to fuck this rich guy. And the rich guy basically says to her, oh, you're a virgin. Come back to me when you're not.
Yeah, after he straight up feels her up.
He, like, grabs her crotch.
Yeah. And so then it's her plot to just fuck Duane so she can dump him and go hook up with the rich guy.
She's so mean to Duane. And the first time that they try to have sex, Duane can't do it. And he keeps telling her,
what's the matter? Aren't you going to do it?
I don't know what's wrong.
What do you mean? How could anything be wrong? Just go on and do it. Oh, what's the matter with you?
I don't know. Something's happened.
Something's different. It's because she doesn't love him anymore. Yeah. She's just using him. And yes, Duane is a little bit dumb, but he really loves her, and he can tell it's not right.
Duane, from to the very end of the movie, never not loves her.
Oh,
and it's
never.
And it's kind of like sad and pathetic in that way, the way he's hanging on. But she really got her claws in deep into him.
Yeah, she did.
But now the Timothy Bottoms character, he's a great character. Timothy Bottoms, not as prolific a role since as he did in Last Picture Show. He did so good here.
That's almost one of the things that makes this so interesting and wonderful, is that I don't know him from anything else.
He did pop up in the 2000s in that Trey Parker, Matt Stone, a spoof comedy about George Bush called That's My Bush.
One of these days, I'm gonna punch you in the face, and then the stomach, and then the face again.
Yeah.
Because when Timothy Bottoms got older, he kind of looked like George W. Bush. So that lent him a few roles as like a stand-in for that character in certain movies. But he's the web of this town, and he's having an affair with the high school coaches. By the way, this team is so laughably bad at sports. Like, I think Sam the Lion says, like, yeah, you guys lost 141-15. Like, an insanely, like,
can I
farcical score.
I feel like I need to finish a couple of the sentences you said.
Sure. Always.
Timothy Bottoms, played by Sonny, is caught up in the web of this town.
Sonny, played by Timothy Bottoms.
That's what I meant. And he is not having an affair with the coaches. He's having an affair with the coach's wife.
This is why finishing sentences is good.
But the coach, like, sets him up. Like, he basically goes to Sonny one day and says, hey, I'll get you out of civics class tomorrow if you'll take my wife to the doctor, because I don't want to go.
Well, maybe the viewer has missed it over the years, but the coach is kind of subtly portrayed as a closet homosexual.
Yes. They, without saying it, they very much hint at it. He kind of grabs just one boy's butt.
Yeah, yeah.
And then after Sonny takes his wife to the doctor, she's crying. She's a very emotional person. The thing that I feel like is really wonderful about Cloris Leachman in this role is that she's very emotional. She hasn't felt anything but sadness in such a long time that she doesn't really know how to feel anything but sadness. And she's crying talking to Sonny, and he says,
is it something bad?
No. Something. Very.
He says something about the coach, like, can you talk to him about whatever? And she just looks at him and she goes, you don't know. And basically she's saying, like, you don't know he's gay. Without saying it. Like, we don't have a relationship.
He's eccentric, how they might say it in a small town.
And, you know, they see each other around town, and they start having an affair. And through the course of this, Cloris Leachman is one of those women who, in our minds, she's always older, you know? But she's you know, maybe in her 40s in this movie. But she's a younger woman.
40, yeah.
And she's one of those ladies who has, like, a very, like, from the mountains, small town, angular, potentially very harsh look to they look old when they're in their teens. Like, they always do. I know people like this. We have people like this in our family.
When we meet Cloris Leachman, she looks like an image of a woman from, like, the Great Depression.
Yes.
And then as the affair continues, she looks more lively, looks more modern. Yeah. She actually genuinely looks happy. Oh, and the whole town.
They know.
Knows.
Everyone knows.
Of course they know.
Everyone knows. And even at one point, Genevieve, without saying it, looks at him and says, you need to be careful. I don't want you to get shot.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's like, what are you talking about? And she's like, Sonny, everybody knows everything, you know? She's like the mom of the town, and Sam the Lion is the dad of the town, and Sonny is the heart of the town.
Yeah, yeah.
Or something, or Sam is the heart of the town. But they're like these people who are so specific that you feel like you know them, and they are, like, stereotypical, but not in a what's the word I'm looking for? It's so genuine. It's not.
It's not
a trope.
It's not tropey.
Yeah, it's not tropey. It's real.
There's this desire through characters, especially with Sonny, that there is this desire to leave this town, but it's not out of, like, anger. Not right. Well, Sonny's a little mad at some things by the end, of course,
and rightfully so.
But I grew up in an environment that wasn't even really a town. It was like an unincorporated place. And I felt like I really had not much choice but to leave to find much of anything.
Right.
But it wasn't a matter of being embittered, or maybe when I was younger I was more embittered. But as I get older, you get a little more perspective. You're a little more grateful at what you look back on. You know, the anger slips away, and you're just kind of more worried about your own mortality and future.
Sure.
But
welcome to your 40s.
Yeah, yeah. Don't. Yeah, it's just pointless to get mad at the things you're mad at in your 20s.
Yeah.
But there's a desire to leave, but it's not necessarily out of hatred.
No.
You know?
Yeah.
And that's what's important to consider. I mean, this movie strikes such a balance. It's just unapologetic. It's, one might interpret it as a condemnation, but it's really not. But it's not lifting it up either. It's just kind of, it is what it is.
There's very few depictions of a small town that feel really real. This is why I want to watch his other movies. I don't know if they're all set in small towns.
I don't think so.
But I like his approach to things. And I know maybe his other movies are not good because they're not around. I don't know.
You know, they're up and down, but he fucking nailed it with this one.
He fucking nailed it with this one. Paris, Texas.
Yeah, the Vin Vendors movie.
To me, is a really good example of that. David Lynch is amazing at the small town kind of mentality. Even though Twin Peaks does kind of have like these comedic moments within the darkness.
Blue Velvet is a small town neo-noir.
Absolutely. Yeah. You know, and it's in those moments. Those are kind of my favorite kind of movies. The ones that are really real about it.
So the character of Sonny, once JC, it's really interesting because JC actually gets, it's hard to say who's seducing who, but her mom is having an affair with this guy named Abilene.
Yeah.
And Abilene comes over because JC, that guy she wanted to marry from Wichita Falls,
Married someone else. After fucking her.
So Abilene comes over to hook up with her mom. But she's there, and she immediately is, like, fawn-eyeing him, right?
She ain't home.
No, your mama went to the club.
What are you doing home on a Saturday night?
She actually has awkward sex with her mom's fucking boyfriend.
It seems like it's good until after, and then he's shitty to her.
Yeah.
Like, it's fine. Like, he takes her to the pool hall, and they have sex on the pool table, but
then she's the victim of his shame.
Yeah, and then so he drops her off, and he's, like, rude to her, and she goes into the house, and her mom gets up because she thinks it's Abilene.
She hears the truck. She knows the sound of Abilene's truck.
Yeah.
JC walks in, and then JC's just like, I don't know why you go with this man, mama.
He's terrible.
This scene is fucking great.
Brilliant.
Because Ellen Burstyn, she's not mad at her daughter.
She doesn't miss a beat.
She goes from being excited to getting some dick to realizing that her daughter had that dick, but she's not mad at her kid. She immediately goes into mom mode, comfort mode, and it's actually a very, like, warped but sweet-ass scene. Is.
She, like, pours her a glass of milk
or
something while they're talking about how this man is a piece of shit, you know? And she also is like, I'm never going to find anybody. There's nobody. And it's like, you're 18.
Yeah, and Duanes.
But that's the thing, though. You're in a small town. It's like, you have to find someone to get you out of that town.
And Duane is off working the rigs. They've broken up at this point.
Yeah.
But Ellen Burstyn, she informs that, like, Sonny has been sleeping with Ruth.
And JC's the only person in town who did not know somehow. That. But that's exciting to her because it's like, oh, he's been fucking an older woman. Like,
yeah,
I need to get him because her whole thing is she wants what she can't have. That rich guy was dating this girl named Annie, which is who he actually married.
Yeah.
But he already had a girlfriend and he had all this money and she thought she was going to steal him away, right? And then she's going to steal her mama's boyfriend, right? And now she's going to steal Ruth's boyfriend. And she wants what she can't have. And as soon as Sonny is all in on her, she doesn't ever fuck him. She just drags him along and has him by her. He says they go out for Mexican food. And
yeah, that's what he says to Duane when Duane confronts him about it.
He dumps Ruth without a word. He just doesn't go back to her house anymore. And Duane shows up in his new car that he bought working these oil rigs.
Ghost Ruth. It's not even official dumping.
No, he just leaves. He just doesn't go back. And he and Duane get in this big fight over JC.
Seen old Leroy last week. Said he thought you and JC had been going together a little.
Yeah, we have, little. She's been kind of bored, so once in a while we go out eat Mexican food or something.
Well, I hear that ain't all you've been eating.
Well, whoever told you that don't know what he's talking about. Sure, I've been going with her. Why not?
I never said I blame you for it. I don't blame you much. I thought you'd do me that way. I thought we were still best friends.
We are. What you so mad for? I never done nothing to you.
Well, I guess screwing my girl ain't nothing to you.
I ain't screwing her.
Hell, you ain't.
Duane busts his eye, and I thought he was going to lose his eye, but it ends up just being a little scar.
It seemed like having a whole patch was melodramatic if you just had a scar
there
right there.
There were comments that were like, I only have one good eye. Like, they yeah. said that. So it was he like, ended this up being make any okay, sense. Though. He ended up yeah. being fine. But when he had gotten in this fight over her, she goes to him and she's like, let's get married.
Yeah, they go elope.
And so they go elope, and they're driving in the car back, and he's trying to, like, put his hand up her dress because, hi, they're married now and they haven't still had sex. And she starts going, geez, wouldn't it be terrible if the cops came and got us? And he's like, well, how would they ever know? And he's just like, I don't know. My parents might send them. I had to leave a note. And then the cop comes down the street. She is visibly more excited at this cop car turning around to pull her over than this man whose hand is up her skirt.
Yeah.
Like, she doesn't give a shit about Sonny. She's using him for attention. Mm. And so now she's getting the attention from her parents.
Let's talk about Sam the Lion real yes. quick. Sam the Lion, he's the father. He owns the movie hall. Theater, the pool hall, and the cafe. And he's just kind of this, he's played by Ben Johnson. Fantastic.
So good.
I heard that Bogdanovich said that Ben Johnson was resistant to the amount of lines that his character had. And I think that monologue was like the one thing that maybe Bogdanovich didn't budge much on. But I think Ben Johnson might have stripped down the lines of his own character.
Well, if he did, he did a brilliant job, because we've all known this guy too. The like strong guy who doesn't say a whole lot. But if you can get him to tell you a story, yeah. which is what happens in that monologue, but it's amazing.
Ben Johnson is basically the father figure to Sonny and to a lot of boys, but mainly to Sonny and this boy named Billy that Sonny looks out for. Billy, as it just so happens, our theme this month being comfort food and the type of movies we're discussing, Billy is a simple boy. He's doesn't talk.
And he's slow. He's probably got yeah. a low IQ, and he's mute.
There's one point where they go to get Billy laid, and they're with these like country ass kids.
Oh, and first they're talking about, let's go fuck a heifer.
Yeah, literally like, pussy's pussy.
Pussy's pussy.
Let's go fuck a heifer. Like, for real. Yeah. And I've heard about this in West Texas. Like, mm-hmm. I've seen old PSA signs, you know.
Pussy's pussy.
Apparently people, there have to be public notifications to not fuck your livestock due to STDs and stuff like that. So, fucking wild shit, you know. Try that in a small town. And I think that's what Jason Aldean means. Come fuck your livestock here in a small town. We like that.
Pussy.
We're into that. I think that's what he meant by that song.
But they eventually decide not to do that and not to go try to buy someone for them all to sleep
with. Good old Jimmy Sue.
But let's call Jimmy Sue the big, rude, brash woman who, I can't remember where she works. And we're going to pay her, because she'll be cheap, to take Billy's virginity.
And Billy busts way quick, and then
Jimmy Sue punches him.
Punches him. So they go back to the pool hall, and Sam the Lion sees Billy bloodied.
Which one of you bloodied his nose? I've told you all not to fight with Billy, because he don't understand about fighting. What happened, Sonny?
They weren't none of us, Sam.
No, it was Jimmy Sue.
Jimmy Sue? How'd he get messed up with her?
We all chipped in and bought him a piece of ass. Thought he was getting tired of being a virgin. She got mad about something and bloodied his nose.
Now, you boys can get on out of here. I don't want to have no more to do with you. Scaring a poor, unfortunate creature like Billy just so as you could have a few laughs. I've been around that trashy behavior all my life. I'm getting tired of putting up with it.
I don't want your patronage no more. I don't want your... And Sonny's there, too. And you can tell he's especially disappointed
in Duane's Sonny. There, too, but he's hiding in the
back
seat.
He's hiding in the truck.
And then later he goes, good thing I was asleep. I want to still be able to play pool. He's such an asshole.
This whole night was sparked off because Duane got fucking ditched by JC.
To go to that party.
To go to Wichita Falls.
To get naked.
That's what really got that whole night going. But
Randy Quaid really thought he was going to get it in with her, but she just used him to get to that party.
So I think it's with the help of Eileen Brennan's character that Sam forgives Sonny.
Not the other boys, though.
No, not the other boys.
And they shouldn't.
So then we get this scene where Sam takes Sonny and Billy to this little pond lake.
They go fishing.
And he talks about how, you know, talks about what the things that kind of change and don't change. And he talked about how, you know, after his, he says that his children died and his wife lost her mind. Like he lost his wife. And it's only in a passing line that he even says that. So Sam's, there's just this guy who's lost an incredible amount. But he talks about how he used to go with this girl.
Me and this young lady was pretty wild, I guess. And pretty deep. We used to come out here horseback and go swimming without no bathing suits. One day she wanted to swim the horses across this tank. Kind of a crazy thing to do, but we'd done it anyway. She bet me a silver dollar she could beat me across. She did. This old horse I was riding didn't want to take the water. But she was always looking for something to do like that. Something wild. I bet she still got that silver dollar.
Boy, if she, you know, if she came back to me today, I'd probably be just as happy then, right now, as I was then.
And Sonny asked him, he was like, why didn't you marry her? And he goes, well, I wanted to, but there was something about he had to go away for a bit. And when he came back, she was married.
Yeah.
Sam the Lion passed.
Yeah, so they go off to, Sonny and Duane go to Mexico. And then everything moves so quick in this movie. It's like we span through a year pretty quick.
I love the way they flip too. They'll just say something like, oh, he's been going with Ruth for 6 months. And then you know it's 6 months forward.
They come back from Mexico and they're just told that Sam the Lion is dead.
And he's left the pool hall to Sonny, Genevieve the diner, and this little old lady that runs the movie theater. He left her the theater.
She's not very confident in it, though. No. So when JC's parents are forcing the annulment between her and Sonny, there's a conversation between JC's mom and Sonny. And you can tell that JC's mom actually really does like him. Mm-hmm. But like, she just wants her daughter to be a yuppie, right? They managed to make the connection that she was the one that Sam the Lion would bring to the watering hole with horses. And she was like, oh, he told you about that, huh? And you kind of got this bit that like, it really meant a lot to her.
To know that he was still,
that she still meant a lot to him.
It's such a heartbreaking small town thing as well, which this shows so perfectly. These two people should have been together, but it just didn't work out. But they never stop loving each other, but they have to see each other all of the time.
Yeah.
And there's like, they haven't spoken probably in 20 years, but they're still in love.
Yeah. It's kind of so weird. Like, in a way it's sweet, but in a way it's another way. It's like, what good does it do? Why exactly. Can't you just be in love? You know? So, you know, after Sam the Lion is gone, it seems like what's left of what's worth going to in the town is fading out. Sonny, Billy gets in a horrible accident. Someone hits him with his car and Sonny ends up passing away. They kill the poor
Billy,
kid.
Billy passes away.
Billy gets hit by a vehicle because Billy would always sweep the street and Sonny walks up on the broom and he sees this circle of good old boys basically like making excuses with each other about why this isn't nobody in their fault.
Going real hard. Right out in front of that station. Christ, trucker didn't have a chance.
Yeah, he's out here all the time doing something.
Sand was blowing.
Yeah.
I never noticed it. Hard to see. Never figured nobody would be in the street.
What was he doing out there anyway, carrying that broom?
Oh, he weren't doing nothing. He's just an old simple-minded kid.
Sorry,
never had no sense.
Your fault.
Hell no, mister. I can see that.
He was just a dumb old kid. Never was good.
Didn't know enough to keep his ass out of the cold. Morning like this.
And they're downplaying the kid. And this is kind of familiar to me, like this little microcosm and this primordial representation of some good old boy bullshit and how easy it is for people to kind of, you know, the only people that are going to be left in this town are these old timers with nothing to do, right?
Yeah.
So they're sitting here just talking each other up about how this boy just ain't got no sense and they ain't worth nothing. And they're like, let's just go get something to eat.
Yeah, they're just going to leave his body in the middle. and, of the street, and who cares?
And Sonny, like, yells at them. He's like, he's just sweeping the street, and he pulls his body away, but, like, they don't care, and they're gone. They go to the last movie is playing before at the picture show. It's shutting down.
And Duane's come home, and he's about to have to go off to the war.
And it's funny because Duane is like, he still asks about JC, and her and Sonny are way over at this point.
And Duane and Sonny make up completely.
And Duane is like, you never slept with her, right? Like, he's still hanging on. He's still making sure. And they go see the movie Red River starring John Wayne. It's the last movie at Sam the Lion's picture show.
And Billy was there, too. That was before.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, because he always would sit up in the up where the projector was.
And then that, and then at, so we're reaching the end, and that's when Sonny goes to talk to Ruth Popper. To Ruth.
This scene is so, this scene broke my heart also. A lot of parts of this movie broke my heart, it felt like. But, you know, he says, can I have a cup of coffee with you? And she lets him in, and she starts to do the coffee, and she says, I'm sorry I look like this. Like, I'm sorry I'm not all dressed. And then she throws the coffee against the wall, and she turns on him, and she's like, why am I apologizing to you? I've been apologizing to you in my house alone for 6 months. Like, you just left me. Mm. You didn't think I was worth an explanation. I'm just some old, ugly woman, you know? And ends up, he just listens to her. He just lets her get it all out, and she's mad, and she's like, you can't just come here because your friend is dead. And then he grabs her hand. And in that moment, there's like this like sad, sweet desperation where they both just look at each other and realize, like, we don't have anybody else. There's nothing else for us. There's no one left. And she just looks at him, and she's like,
thanks kind of godly. Mrs. O'Malley, out in the valley, suffered from ulcer, I understand.
Never you mind, honey. Never you mind.
Never you mind, honey. And you know they're back together, but it's so different than it was before because now they're just sad.
Yeah. And that's the last picture show. Also, check out the porn parody, The Last Glory Hole.
Oh, yeah.
Man, you know your town's in trouble when it can't even keep the glory hole open. You know? Yeah. Also, in that movie, Ruth Popper is played by Cloris Leachman. It's really good. And just as sad.
Sonny's her stepson or some shit like that.
Yeah. So, yeah. We're going to... Let's rate this movie now.
Yeah. All together now?
Come on. This movie's so fucking good.
It's a 5.
It really is a classic American movie.
It is.
I don't know why it took me so long. Took us so long to get to it. But it is just... The emotions, the way it's displayed, the heart and the heartlessness. It's the strikes maybe one of the best small town movies you will ever see. That and The Last Glory Hole, both just top notch. So, and look, I think we already set it up. Now I've been shifting around our reviews. We've got the movies separated in their specific number, but when it hits S tier or F tier, it's just all a straight line. And yeah. This is, I'm 5, you're a 5. This is, movies don't get much better than this.
No, folks. No, this is so amazing.
Peep this, look near the bottom there. Also, I've shifted the S tier ratings. If you basically clear a 9, you are S tier. So in that sense, the movies Tangerine.
Mm-hmm.
Bride of Frankenstein and Out of the Past are now S tier.
Absolutely. And you pulled a few out, right? Because like Crimes of the Future.
Yeah, yeah. I don't think that didn't make S tier.
Okay, good.
But that did get lowered. Some got shipped around from our original scores. We said we were going to do that. But you can go through later and shift around the way you might want to adjust things yourself later.
I trust you.
But our scores are right now, many are, but a lot of our movies, maybe we're too hard on this one. Maybe we're too hyped on it.
The more we do this, the more refined we get in what we're looking for and what is good to us. There's a lot of stuff we watched early on that I think we gave a higher score than we would now just because we were being nice or something.
But the last picture show, easy S tier. Mm-hmm. Easy. No hesitation there. And Bogdanovich, you know, he's at least got one masterpiece under his belt. Good, good stuff. I wouldn't mind watching this again soon. I just felt like there was so much to grab onto here. The little nuances, the emotional turns, the camera's not afraid to get into characters' faces as they're experiencing certain things. It's both comical and endearing, and it's just good shit. Yeah. So check the show notes for links to other places to find us. Let us know. Surely you've seen Last Picture Show if you're a movie fan. We're not movie experts. We're movie fans, but we are getting there in terms of getting better at talking about movies. Like, subscribe, leave a comment. Tell us what you think about Last Picture Show or Last Glory Hole. Who's your favorite character in Last Glory Hole? We love you.
Life to all lovers.
Anarene High School, we love you ever so grand. We will always be so loyal out to the man. Whether in defeat or victory, we will always be true. Anarene High School, we love you and we'll fight for you.
I say a heifer beats nothing.
Pussy's pussy.